Welcome to Gotta Run. This is Will Sanchez. My special guest today is Dail St. Clair. Wow, what a story. 2016 was a pivotal year for Dail in many, many ways. Later that year, she joined Achilles International as a volunteer. To all she met, she brought hope and possibility. In particular, Sissel Marcus, a disabled runner from Norway, who came to New York to run her first New York City Marathon. Dail and her crew were the guiding lights, and together with Sissel, had an adventure never to be forgotten. Priceless. I'm honored to have Dail as a guest.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
It's a pleasure. Dail, before we go through the adventures you had with Sissel, which is a totally inspiring story, let's introduce you to our audience. Tell us where you were born, something about your growing up years.
I was born in Washington, D.C. I grew up on the East Coast and the West Coast, and I went to college in University of California at San Diego, and immediately after grad school at University of Chicago.
In college, what did you major in?
I majored in biology and anthropology, which the story behind that is I started out as pre-med. Most of my family is in law and medicine. And about third year, I decided that was not going to be my path. So I focused on anthropology, which I loved, and eventually went on to immediately to grad school.
And what did you study in grad school?
Public policy and business.
Well, that's a big change there. What led you to that?
I started at University of Chicago in public policy with the knowledge that I would be able to take courses in any of the other grad schools. As a pre-med, you just pretty much focus on the sciences.
Yeah.
And I really didn't have exposure to anything else, notwithstanding the fact that my parents are in medicine, dentistry, and law. And so I started to take classes in the other grad schools and discovered business was grad school that I was most interested in. And that's how I ended up graduating from University of Chicago.
Excellent. Well, during your studies, were you active athletically?
I was not an athlete as a child or in college. I grew up in recreational sports, just below competitive level in everything. I played classical piano. I danced classical ballet. I recreational tennis, recreational cycling. Just everything below competitive level.
Well, not everything has to be competitive. Tell something about you.
My friends were competitive, so I knew the difference between competing and not, for sure. So I was a great cheerleader.
So you had fun doing those things.
I always had fun. There's no question I had fun.
And that's what counts, having fun.
Absolutely.
And you get the benefits anyway.
Absolutely.
Okay. So after the University of Chicago, you needed, or you probably wanted to decide a career for yourself. What was the process for that?
There wasn't a process, to be honest with you. University of Chicago grad who brought me into Continental Bank, where I had already been working at Continental Bank Foundation to between first and second year to help pay tuition. And I ended up in their training program and discovered sales and trading, and just spent the last 20 years in finance. Different areas of finance, so that's while I raised my children.
Excellent. At some point, you made it to New York. So what was the process of coming to New York?
Continental Bank actually transferred me to New York, so it was a promotion. Congratulations. I was actually planning to go back to San Francisco, but they didn't have an office there. So I dutifully went to New York with Continental. I'd stayed there 3 months and then jumped to Bankers Trust. And then worked for a New York City pension fund before going to a small firm after that.
At some point, you discovered running because you're wearing a very attractive shirt that you're a member of Achilles International. So how did the running and when did the running start?
The running started 5 years ago. And my youngest went to boarding school. My oldest was already in college. I was working, continued to work full-time, and I was challenged by a dear friend in San Francisco to participate in a run walk for Crohn's and colitis, as participate on her team, which is a charity team in training.
Excellent.
And I thought we were walking. I remember thinking, how long was it going to take us to walk the Sonoma Half Marathon? And I was with the walkers, they were with the runners, and looking over at me, and I said, what are you doing there? And they go, what are you doing over there? It's like, well, I thought we were walking. I'm like, well, we thought you could run. You look like a runner. We decided to do this together as a team. I'll go over here with you. I'll be in the back. And that was how I started running. I started running. Many of the people in the back had Crohn's. It was an amazing, amazing experience.
Wow. And I guess you did finish the, I guess you did a walk run.
Well, I did a walk run. I eventually moved to the middle of the pack during that training of 15 weeks. And in our little group, we all finished. And it felt so wonderful. I wanted to keep doing this. There were so many experiences that I had during this training period. I realized I loved training. Camaraderie and really what it does to your body. You know, as you know, running is about mental fitness and physical fitness. Mm-hmm. And I experienced both. At the time, I was going through some challenges with my daughter, who was ill at the time, and it was just a way of helping sort things out and anchor life, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I looked for another race to train for. So my first marathon was 5 months later, the Chicago Marathon.
Oh, excellent, excellent. And you know Chicago because you went to school there?
Absolutely, which is why I couldn't wait to go.
And what kind of training did you do for Chicago?
I got Hal Hignon's book. And read it and just used the book. And I really just followed his program. I didn't, I was traveling bi-coastal. I was traveling a lot. I kept in touch with my running friends in San Francisco. And I had a running group in Chicago and a running group in Orange County. Ironically, I didn't have a running group in New York. So that's how I trained.
And how did you do in Chicago?
Chicago, I finished in 4 hours and 28 minutes. At the time, I was just grateful to finish. I didn't have a Garmin. I didn't have any expectations in time. I didn't know a lot about strategy. And I was happy that I finished and looked forward to my next marathon.
All right, so you now clearly got the bug for running.
Absolutely.
And so what was the next step?
To look for another race. I like setting goals, and for me, a race is a goal. It's the training for the race that's the joy. So I set my next race, and I knew some people who ran the Rock and Roll Marathon, and started to focus on their marathons. And it picked Rock and Roll in San Diego, which was 6 months later in June.
Timetable is really compressed there, four months, now 6 months. So you're still in constant training because you got another one coming up in 6 months.
My goal when I started running was to run two marathons a year if I was healthy, so that ultimately I would be training year round. That's what running has become for me.
Okay.
It's become lifestyle.
Excellent.
And I started long, as you see. So that was that's just how I started, and I loved it.
How did San Diego go for you?
San Diego, I was one of three people that missed the turn, and I finished at 21 miles. So I never did the marathon. The signal was, they still don't know how I managed to do that. That's a true story, and I'm saying it on.
Luckily, there was two others. I made them.
There were two others, exactly. So I ran Seattle four weeks later.
To make up for that.
To make up for that, I trained to do a marathon.
So you were determined to do 26.2.
Oh, I was not going to end the month of June without having run 26.2 marathon.
Well, did you know when you crossed the finish line or later?
Oh no, I knew. I knew. I didn't feel. I told them. I said no. I did not run. I told them, and then they. then obviously they track you.
I guess they call it a DQ.
They comped me and the other two runners to run Seattle. It was very kind of them. I ran Seattle and it was beautiful. And San Diego was beautiful too. The 21 miles was beautiful and Seattle was a lot of fun.
Great. So San Diego turned out to be a training run.
Yes, and exactly.
You were really ready.
I was really
for
ready for Seattle, and I kept my time kept improving, so I was happy with that.
Do you recall your time for Seattle?
I recall every marathon time. Yes, it was 4:11, 4 hours and 11 minutes.
All right, that is a significant improvement. But now you know, I want to go below four. I can hear clicking.
I was thinking about that, as a matter of fact, as I was plotting out my next race. I ran New York. That was my first New York.
And how did you get into New York? Was it to the lottery?
I got into New York with the 9+1 program.
Excellent. Very common way of doing it, running nine races for New York Roadrunners.
Absolutely.
And volunteering at least once.
Absolutely.
And
yes.
Guaranteed entry for the following year.
That's
so you
did
that in 2012,
yes.
2013.
That's
so
what I did.
So at this time, you're in New York, you're doing all these runs. Were you a member of a club at that point?
No, I didn't join. I just kept running with Hal Hignon. and traveling. I was still somewhat bi-coastal. I had opened the Chicago office for my company, so now I was New York, Chicago, San Francisco.
So at this point in time, you're now a bona fide runner. You're running every state you're in, Chicago, California, you've done New York, and you got your first New York under your belt.
Yes.
How did the first New York go?
That was fantastic, because I remember it because I just qualified for Boston by 2 seconds. It was 3 hours and 58 minutes or something. You know, I might be off a second or two, but yeah.
For your age group at that time, Boston was 4 hours?
Exactly. So yes, I BQ'd. I didn't know what that was. Someone said you BQ'd. I thought they were talking about a barbecue. Like, what is that? And then that was also just under the qualifying time for New York the following year.
All right, so you did New York again a second time.
Right, I did.
And probably you loved it as well.
Absolutely.
Were you a member of a team at that point?
No.
You're still unattached?
I'm an unattached runner? Unattached runner.
Okay.
Unattached
and then you did
runner.
Boston?
Then I did Boston, and then I did New York. And by then, so that was a total of 7 marathons.
And 3 New Yorks.
And 3 New Yorks. And then, quite honestly, Will, that's when I had to pause. I had signed up. I already put my registration for Boston for 16, and I was just burnt out, which was unexpected. And I'm so grateful that I met a seasoned runner who just started talking to me about my running.
Mm-hmm.
And I shared with them, and he said, well, did you ever do a 5K? And I said, well, no, I never raced a 5K. I never raced a 10K. I've always focused on the marathon. And he said, just run short. And join, he told me to join the Flyers. He was a member of the Flyers, and he thought that I really needed a running club to support my running. Joined the Flyers January 2016,
okay.
And I joined their Run Smart training program. I knew I wasn't going to run Boston. I took that off the table. It just mentally felt right.
Mm-hmm.
This was not going to be my year, I said, maybe to run a marathon at all.
Mm-hmm.
And my friend who was the Flyers member and seasoned runner just said, focus on short races, enjoy running. He told me about other races in Connecticut that I've never run before to diversify the New York experience. And so I ran with him in Connecticut a few times, and I just started to really feel the way I did a few years ago, just look forward to getting up and run.
Right.
I had gotten into a mode where I didn't look forward to a marathon.
Okay.
That's whereas all the other years I truly had.
Okay.
I started to dread them.
Oh, wow. So you hit the reset button. Luckily, your friend.
Thank goodness.
Recognized the symptoms of overrunning.
I guess that's what you call it.
One of the advantages you soon discovered belonging to a club, lots of collective experiences.
Oh, it was fantastic. It was fantastic to be in a community of runners, some who I'd seen in the park before, just sort of you sort of friendly say hi. And it was a fantastic experience to be a member of a club where all levels are running.
Some people call it a tribe.
Sure, and I can see why.
Sometimes think it's a family, but it's really more of a tribal thing. You know?
Yes.
You're in there for the hunt.
Absolutely.
And your shoes are your weapons.
Right. No, exactly. Exactly.
Okay, well, something interesting happened. We mentioned 2016 was a very pivotal year, a year of growth for you in many ways. So in 2016, you decided for some reason to join Achilles.
Well, the reason I decided to join Achilles is I remembered how much joy I had running New York, and I wanted to give that joy to someone else. I genuinely wanted to help someone else cross the finish line, and that's when I decided to join Achilles. At that point, this was in August of 16, at that point I also got my legs back, and I was so thrilled to get my legs back, and it was too late to run New York, and I really wanted at that point to help someone else cross New York. So I found another race, the Mohawk Marathon, which is a month before New York, and I could get one marathon in that year. As it turned out, I got two, because the second one was a guide. I was working with all disabled runners. Achilles in New York trains on Tuesdays and Saturdays, and many people are visually impaired. Some people are mentally impaired.
Every Saturday at 10 o'clock, you see them at Engineers Gate with the vans.
Yes.
and the guys with the shirts. It's very inspiring to see you guys come in on Saturday mornings. And a lot of clubs are usually wrapping up their long runs for,
exactly,
for the morning as you guys come in.
That's right.
Cool. Okay, so obviously, you enjoyed the experience, and they must have liked you because you were given a challenge. A runner from Norway came in under your wings. Well, tell us that story.
Well, that was complete serendipity in so many ways. As you know, as we've spoken about, Cecil Marcus is a disabled runner. I mean, she is a visually impaired and deaf. Happens to be a single mom as well with three children. She was born deaf and mute.
Oh my gosh.
And she did train as a runner with that disability, being deaf and mute, for a short time until she had her first baby. And then she was unable to run for 25 years. So last year, she started running again after all that time. At that point, she was 55 years old and started running with Achilles in Norway. Had a goal, was run walking and moving. And 10 years ago, she became visually impaired.
Oh my gosh.
So when she started running again, she was obviously deaf and mute as she was born, and she was also visually impaired.
Exactly. This is a remarkable story.
Completely.
Just before even getting to New York here.
She has two interpreters, and they came to New York, and she, with the goal of finishing New York City Marathon, and it was an amazing opportunity to be her guide. I learned three things from her, which was first struck me: her depth of gratitude for life, her conviction to dream impossible dreams and to achieve them. The running community in New York welcomed her with open arms. I could not have done the race without the help of the running community. Unfortunately, the flyers did not assist Cecil, reasons I still am not sure, but every other running club upon hearing about Cecil welcomed her. Shalene Flanagan inscribed a book, Carpe Diem, to her new book.
Shalene, the Olympian.
The Olympian,
so
yes.
So she got to meet Cecil?
She didn't get a chance to meet her in person, but they spoke. And Cecil, it's hard for her to travel with the disability. She has two full-time interpreters. We went on that 9-hour journey, as it turned out, with the guidance of a the seasoned runner, actually, who introduced that I met a year ago.
Okay, who got you into the Flyers.
He's no longer a member of the Flyers, but he was definitely one of the crew members.
And the two interpreters themselves.
And the two interpreters, they ran, never ran a marathon before.
Oh my God, so you had three of them then,
I was
really,
three
guiding
of them,
three.
And our strategy was modified with my veteran runner friend on the by phone. Another runner friend met us on the course with chicken soup.
Yeah,
all
that's
the way.
Alan Gardner.
Right.
In fact,
exactly.
I heard of your story through Alan.
Oh, okay.
I was following through his Facebook page.
Oh.
And he mentioned, he was doing the table for Project Purple.
Yes.
And he was going to go and meet you and Sissel from Norway. And he had chicken soup.
Made a big difference to us, you know, at mile 17 to have chicken soup for sure with
Alan
the salt.
Gardner,
it was fantastic.
The former president of New York Flyers, he came through for you.
Yes, no, he did, and did others, and I was just truly grateful that he helped us cross the finish line.
Now, does Sissel speak English? I'm confused. How was the communications?
Sissel is mute.
Mute. Oh, she doesn't speak.
And
so sign language?
Sign language. So we...
Wait a minute. She's all legally blind, so she can see
she's
something.
She's visually impaired. So she sees the shadows. And we spoke through the interpreter who speaks English as well as sign. That's why she has two interpreters. They've been with her 10 years. They
wow.
help her in daily living.
Wow.
They've never run before, but when she wanted to embrace this journey,
they said,
said we're in this together.
Wow,
so they've never run more than 13 miles.
You had a lot on your plate to guide these people, but luckily you were ready. Faced your own fears.
Well, I was not ready to take on that challenge, to be honest with you, and I could not have taken on that challenge without the help of my running friend, who's a veteran runner, a 30-year veteran runner.
Well, what's his name?
Marat Vizet.
Good for him. Wow. Mm-hmm. The communication with her sounds very interesting. So you speak in English. They translate in Norwegian,
yes,
sign language?
Yes, exactly.
And
so on the course, we would shift because it takes a lot of work for them to do that. So every few miles, shift interpreters,
okay.
One in the back, one in the front. I was on the side. Another evolution that happened over the course of our 5 days together is Sissel started holding my arm, which she did not the first 3 days that we met. Took her a while to trust me. And by the end of the race, I was helping to guide along with the interpreters. And then when she asked me that she wanted to run the last 400 meters with me, I was almost in tears. Oops.
Oh my gosh.
That we crossed the finish line together.
Oh, so smart. So she got here 5 days early or some week earlier.
Yeah, so I had a chance to take her to dinner several times, actually. We actually saw her every day. We did some sightseeing together and then saw the Statue of Liberty. After the marathon, I had contacted the Norwegian consulate. They honored her with a tour of the United Nations. She was just overwhelmed at the welcoming of the running community and of the Norwegian consulate. Absolutely overwhelmed that people would be so thoughtful of a stranger and be so interested in what she was doing. She's one of the most humble, gracious women I've ever met.
And brave, I have to
completely brave.
My hat.
I mean, her courage.
Able-bodied people would have been terrified to do half the things that this woman has done. That's amazing. So I guess she's back in Norway?
She returned to Norway with her interpreters. We email each other once in a while, touching base. I think I told you that I had a concussion after Christmas, and Sissel was very, it was just so neat to speak to her because of all her disabilities, her reaching out to me and empathizing with what I was experiencing at the time very touching.
Communicate through email, so I guess, how does she?
We do communicate through email, and I know it's hard for her. It often takes 4 or 5 days.
Because she has to get it in Braille or something.
Well, exactly.
Awesome.
And quite honestly, since I had the concussion and part of the treatment is staying off of electronics, I never really appreciated the work involved in emailing is second nature to everybody. This has been a humbling experience in terms of really what we take for granted every day, which is truly why, for me, running is such an amazing gift. I mean, just moving, frankly, is such an amazing gift to have our health and be able to move any time that we want is a privilege.
Okay. All right. So just to make clear to the audience, you are recovering from a concussion that you had in early December.
Yes, I am.
Just before Christmas.
I am.
And the prognosis is very, very good.
Oh, I will have a full recovery. I have great doctors at New York City Presbyterian. They have a concussion center. My doctor is a runner. So I've been under excellent care. Thank you for asking.
Well, listen, we need you healthy. And we want to see you again out there. And I guess you're going to continue as an Achilles guide.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We're very, very lucky to have you.
Well, thank you. I'm Achilles has given me more than I could ever hope to give. I truly mean that. And I think for that, I'd say the same thing about running. And I am so grateful that I was able to meet Cecil. I'm so grateful that I was able to... She guided me in more ways than I can ever begin to say.
She's a remarkable woman. I can see, you know, just being around her and that positivity that she has. And you want to learn what he sees. And obviously, he sees better than most.
I couldn't have said it better at all. She definitely sees better than most. And I think embracing running as a different discipline and a lifestyle for her has truly elevated her journey, and be able to come back to running, and how thrilled she is that she's able to run, and she can only run once a week.
Wow!
Because she needs assistance.
That's right.
And she has interpreters, and they're not runners. So she can only run once a week. So what a privilege it is for us to run. I believe it. Privilege comes obligation.
Right.
Obligation to help others. That's the way I think. That's the way I live.
That's a beautiful way to think. And on a quick story, I think you told me that back in Norway, that sometimes Greta White's husband joined Cecil.
Yes. Oh,
what a
yes.
Great story.
And Alan Gardner actually shared that with me, and he learned that in the conversation he had with Cecil.
When they had we sharing the soup together?
Exactly, we were having the soup together.
That's amazing. And
she
communicated with sign language.
Yes.
And he got the story out of it.
Yes.
Listen, on that note, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you, Will.